All right. So good morning, everyone. My name is Kyle Barish. I'm the Chief Marketing Officer of Holistic Industries. And Holistic Industries is probably the largest private multi-state operator in the U.S. and really, really proud to be part of it. And as this company is really hitting its stride, we made some big promises, some big declarations. So Josh Genderson, who's the CEO, is here, and Mish Kulik, who's our outside general counsel, is here. They spoke yesterday at a fireside chat, and they talked about the rationale of why Holistic Industries should be the best place to workshop and invest in the industry. And that's a big declaration that we're trying to live into. But another big promise that we're talking about is this idea of creating a greenhouse of brands. A greenhouse of brands, a diverse, worthy, and distinctive group of brands. And while that sounds like a cool and interesting promise, as I've joined the company and started getting really involved in the industry, I'm realizing that's a lot harder than it looks. It's simple but not easy. So one of the big things that we have to do is think about what are the requirements to grow a true greenhouse of brands in the cannabis industry today, which is a very dynamic place. So one area is around changing the conversation. Clearly the conversation in cannabis today is not where we want it to be to maximize or optimize our opportunity. That's for sure. So we're going to have to change that, and that's not an easy thing to do. You can't build a greenhouse of brands unless you have a reliable infrastructure. If you have an infrastructure that you can build upon, you have to be able to get product to market and not just have a creative idea. It actually has to be executed. And then finally, truth over hype is extremely important. There is so much misinformation in this marketplace, and as large players that are creating brands, we have a responsibility and a need to change that and bring more credibility to the market that's ever been there before. So growing a greenhouse of brands requires changing the conversation, as I talked about. So this, I'm hoping you will agree, is the coolest slide over the last 2 days that you've seen. You haven't seen a cooler slide. Tell me a cooler slide that you've seen than that. You haven't. So my name is, as it says, Kyle Barish, and before I came here, I was the CEO of a large ad agency, the largest healthcare advertising agency in the world called CDM. We're part of Omnicom, big publicly traded holding company that deals with all communications. But prior to growing that career, and that was an agency of 9 agencies in 8 countries and 700 employees, et cetera, $100 million in revenue, the big inflection point in my own personal career was being in the in charge of the launch of Viagra. And most of you in the room are old enough for sure to remember our time when a guy would not go to a doctor and have a conversation about impotence. No guy's going to go to their doctor and say, I'm impotent. It's just not going to happen. It's embarrassing. It's stigmatized. It's not medical. It's not right. So when Pfizer came to us and said that they have a pill and they want to launch an impotence pill, we said, it's a cool idea for sure, but you cannot launch an impotence pill. So we unearthed new language, language that's in medical textbooks, erectile dysfunction. You're all familiar with it now, ED, erectile dysfunction. People are walking in and said, I think I walked into the wrong room, but we're okay. You're in the right place. So we changed the whole language, ED. We brought Bob Dole in. We got him to talk about it, and we destigmatized that whole conversation. So now a guy's not going to the doctor and saying that he's impotent. He mentions ED, doctor knows, patient knows, and $26 billion later, Viagra's been a big hit. It's been a big hit for Pfizer and for men who've taken it and for their partners who've enjoyed the benefits of it as well. So when you think, it's not a big stretch to think about that destigma, that conversation in the ED world to the conversation we want to bring to cannabis. Now, we happen to find a Viagra-shaped pill flower that we grew in our Monson, Massachusetts. This particular flower is testing at 32 and has been submitted to the Harvest Cup, so we're hoping that we get good news there. But when you look at the cannabis industry, clearly the conversation is not right. And we believe that taking a lot of the things that we've learned from the healthcare industry and changing conversations in very difficult and stigmatized areas, like an ED, can be brought to the cannabis industry. So that's definitely one of the big requirements we're trying to tackle as we enter our greenhouse of brands. Another big aspect is growing to grow a greenhouse of brands is building on a reliable infrastructure. And we heard from a lot of MSOs over the last few days about what their infrastructure is like. And I don't think that anyone would have ever designed an industry to look this way, to take the kitchen and the brands and the lab and the cultivation and the distribution and put it together in some sort of theoretically pretty unwieldy thing. It's not an easy thing to be experts in all of these and weave them all together into a cohesive and integrated whole that's actually going to get product to market. It's extremely complicated to execute in cannabis. But if you are an operational backbone that's pretty frictionless, multi-state operators who can get product reliably from cultivation, from seed, all the way to sale, it's that combined with the sort of brilliance of brand building is where the winners are going to be. We don't believe that being a brand alone is the easiest place to be today. We think it's the combination of that MSO infrastructure and brand building abilities, and of course the ability to change the conversation. Those things together is what is going to help us build a greenhouse of brands. Another thing we're focused on, which is also in that sort of conversation, but it's a little more acute and it's a little more scary, which is all the conversation, the question we just had about vape in the last presentation. This is a serious situation. We're working in an industry where people are getting injured and worse killed, right, by taking black market product. But the conflation and the confusion between e-cigarettes and flavored tobacco and black market vape and what happens in a legal dispensary, it's so confusing to consumers. Could your vape be killing you is like the kind of headlines we're seeing. And anyone who's a CBD-only manufacturer, coming from pharma, where we have to get everything approved by regulators, and we make claims, and you actually have to support those, these miracle cures of CBD are just not going to make it. The idea of marijuana is going to stop Alzheimer's and cure cancer. I'm very hopeful of all the benefits of marijuana and cannabis as medicine, absolutely. But I just don't want to be that industry that, you know, you go back and you look at a cigarette ad from 1950s, and it's like, cigarettes are the healthiest part of your day or whatever, and we laugh about it now because they look so silly. We don't want to be the industry that creates the cigarette ads of today that we look back and are embarrassed about. It's got to be truth over hype, credibility, evidence, data. You don't say things that aren't true. It just seems basic, but clearly in the marketplace, that's not happening. If you're going to build a greenhouse of brands, it requires truth over hype. Now, so it's not all bad. There are some excellent brands out there that are helping evolve this conversation in a very compelling way. We think the conversation around dosing and control is excellent, and we want to build on the shoulders of that great work. 1906, the edibles brand in Colorado, adds other ingredients to make their chocolate brands more functional. I think that's a cool idea, and we should build on that great idea. The whole industry is excited about the Lowell Cafe and the consumption lounges. And we know, you remember so much about what's told to you, and you remember something like 80% of what you experience. And Lowell Cafe is just the beginning of a changing world of experiences, whether it be through tourism or what have you. And then brands that are inculcating themselves into our culture using celebrities, using other opportunities. The conversation is evolving in the right direction, in bits and pieces, slowly but surely, and we want to take a leadership role at Holistic as it relates to that. One of the many things that are different about the sort of real world and the bizarre world of cannabis is this idea of local brands going from local brands all the way through the process, regional, national, global. Spent my whole career launching essentially national brands that become global. And this idea that we have local brands, how much do they have to change when we go from one market to another? Do we have to adopt regional differences? These are the big questions we're wrestling with. Because you think about like Yingling or something, right? I'm in Princeton, New Jersey, near Philadelphia, and Yingling is one of those places, right? Like that, one of those beers that were trapped in a region, and then they had all the infrastructure and all the benefits in order to get that product to be a national brand, the Utz's and Hellman's. So which are the brands in our industry, they're going to go from local brands and then going to expand to national brands. And there's a lot of thinking about that, right? Clearly, as I mentioned before, a frictionless operational backbone. If you're not in all these states, if you're not in East Coast and West Coast, if you can't get product to market, if you don't have distribution, if you can't get products on shelf, if you don't have a good sales force, you cannot expect to go from a local brand to truly a national brand. And as you're marching down that path to go from local to regional to national, you can't get into an off-ramp of compliance. We are so obsessed with getting compliance right. Again, coming from a pharma background, we don't want any off-ramps in our sort of trajectory to excellence. Clearly, if we heard anything in the last couple of days, is this idea of an access to capital. Capital has become very, very precious, and clearly that's going to fuel the future of these brands. But for me, particularly as a more of a you know, marketing, advertising, brand builder person, I'm very, very focused, and we're very, very focused on understanding local and universal human insights to build our greenhouse of brands. And that's what I want to go to next. I joined Holistic Industries. There are a lot of multi-state operators that I could have joined. There are bigger ones. There are certainly more well-known ones. There are clearly more public ones. But Holistic Industries had a number of aspects that was just very, very attractive to someone who wanted to leave that world and enter this very exciting cannabis world. So clearly you know what our aspiration is. Some of you met Josh yesterday. Really interesting story to be a fourth generation family business coming from the wine and spirits business. And in their fireside chat yesterday talked about from wine to weed to what's next. All the lessons that he and his team have learned in that business and bring it to the cannabis industry. First person and the first organization to bring CBD to DC to treat kids with epilepsy. And in a very challenging market, in a very capital intensive market, being an excellent steward of capital and compliance. You know, I was thinking about my flight on the way home. And my flight, my seat is 35B. Okay, you know what freaking 35B is. That is the last seat in the middle. So if you want to talk about a steward of good capital, I am the poster child of helping Holistic reach that goal. So thank you. You're welcome. Also, we have really inviting spaces. So Liberty is the name of our dispensary brand. And they're very inviting spaces. They're designed by the same person who designed Gap Canada. And we're gonna have 20 of those dispensaries by next year in all our multiple states, supported by super advanced cultivation, awesome extraction process. But I wanted to spend just a moment on Liberty Cannabis Cares. We heard quite a bit yesterday about you kind of can't be in this business unless you're thinking about social equity, unless you're thinking about diversity, unless you're thinking about cannabis literacy. And so we're getting pretty obsessed about this as well. And we've created Liberty Cannabis Cares as a way of collecting all of the different things we're already doing and that we're going to be doing in all of our local communities. So whether it be helping people over the hump and understanding about cannabis, whether it be about helping local communities that are often in sort of disenfranchised areas, or whether being deeply involved in the social equity programs in each of the states where we work. So Holistic Industries is definitely a great place that we're very proud to be a part of. So the greenhouse of brands that we're building are based on deep customer insights, as I mentioned, and each brand has its own sort of story of how we got to that idea. We want to create brands that handle today's customer and also tomorrow's customer across form factors and across geographies. So you sort of get a little bit of sampling, the names of our stores, as you say, Liberty, and a little bit of sampling of some of our brands. So to dive in a little deeper, all the new people coming into cannabis need to learn about our products. And people have different learning styles. Something we focus a lot in the pharma world is making sure that people have the literacy to understand all of the complicated words that we introduce to them in the healthcare space. It's very, very complicated for people. So as you could see, you could learn by color, you could learn by the wing shape, you could learn by our feelings from serenity to vitality, you could learn from the traditional sativa to indica. So no matter how you want to learn, we have a product line that's very welcoming. I think it's a little bit of a department store looking brand. It's maybe a little more female friendly, and it's definitely for new people entering the market, which is clearly the future of our business. But not everyone's like that. We have today's customer, and today's customer is a little different. They want most THC for the dollar. They know exactly what they want. They know what strain they want. They know what form factor they want, and they walk in and they ask for it. We created a brand called Strain just to really answer their needs. It's not a lot, not as fancy. It maybe has a little bit of a better price point, and people can walk in and get exactly what they want. We need something for every different customer segment, and I personally would have thought that the new customers would have come in faster and the older customer types would have come in, would have moved on or have been sort of supplanted by the soccer moms that everyone's talking about. It's happening, but a little slower in some respects than others. This is what's propping up the, certainly the East Coast market right now. We are about to launch, I'm very proud to introduce our edibles brand at the end of this year and into the beginning of next year. The edibles brand, we're always looking for insights that we can learn from, as I said, the real world and import them into that bizarre world in which we're all working, into the cannabis industry. So when you think about candy and what's going on in candy trends, there's a lot of cool things that are happening. But one of the things that we really focused on is mindful indulgences or 100 calorie snacks. So if anyone's ever been to Dylan's candy bar in New York City, you go in and there's all these really excessive ways that you can have candy. But then there's a section called mindful indulgences, and that's where the line is. 100 calorie packs, more sort of in tune with today. So we are creating an entire edibles line with the mindset that people aren't gonna sit and eat some gummies and sit on the couch anymore. That's just not the way the world works. And we're really excited to take that insight and bring it into the launches that you're gonna see soon coming out of Holistic. Finally, we have a medical forward brand that's coming early next year. This is something obviously very near and dear to my heart and to my background and to the expertise that I'm hopefully bringing to Holistic. So when you think, right now, there's very, very little understanding from doctors. If you have a doctor who's over 45 years old, they don't know really anything about cannabis, in most, with a few exceptions, in almost any market. And what every doctor says to us in our research is they need evidence. They need some sort of data so that they can recommend something specifically to the consumers and patients that actually need that. So we have to provide that for them. And the consumers that are coming in, which are older and older, and perhaps more female than male, they need permission. They have grown up in a world their entire lives of reefer madness, and weed's bad, and that's for stoners, and everything that we've heard about so much over the last few days. They need permission from an authority figure. If there's anything that I know to my core, is that conversation between a doctor and a consumer about a difficult conversation like we started with the Viagra conversation. And we're gonna bring a medical forward line of products under the Holistic Greenhouse of Brands we're super proud of and really excited to introduce. So I will say thank you for your attention. Again, Kyle Barish, we believe that growing a greenhouse of brands is definitely gonna require changing that whole conversation and building it on the reliable infrastructure that we think we're getting at Holistic. So I'll say thank you and open it up for questions.
Thank you. As one of the older women in the demographic that you're trying to target, who doesn't feel that she needs permission from an authority figure, how is it that you are planning on messaging that permission-based recommendations? Because in Florida, where I am from, as you know, it's vertically integrated. The physicians may not dispense, they may only refer. So how is it that you are planning on marketing this so that women like me are not immediately offended by the concept that I need permission from a doctor to get involved in cannabis?
Sure, I definitely appreciate the question. Permission is we'll call it a marketing term, right? In terms of, if you may be a progressive thinker and you may have more experience in this marketplace, but across the sort of vast swath of our country in which we have operations, most people don't have a real comfort level in having this conversation. And they feel they need someone who has more expertise than them to help them along this path. We know that doctors don't prescribe cannabis, and we know that most doctors don't want to recommend people coming in to say, oh, just go smoke a joint, you'll feel better. They're looking for something that feels dosed, specific, data-backed, et cetera. So that permission, I think, comes from the data that we share, and it comes from whether they speak to a physician or not. It gives them the sort of the ability to just feel comfortable making a decision that they may otherwise not feel comfortable. People who are already in the marketplace or already comfortable, they don't need anyone to tell them anything. But I appreciate your question. Do you have a follow-up? Ah, okay, got it. Okay, so the question is, do people have a different conversation with men versus women? The answer is no, not particularly. It just happens to be that women take care of themselves and men don't. So I don't know if you've ever met a man who doesn't go to the doctor, who doesn't handle a lot of their issues. Women tend make almost all the healthcare decisions for the household. Women are much more active in trying to make the sort of, they're just much more proactive in trying to make some of the decisions. So we put a picture of a woman and we have discussion about women because they're just the first movers, and then what you know what they're going to do is they're going to get partners and men, etc., to do their bidding, as what happens in every other healthcare category. Thanks for your question. Yes.
If I'm correct, you're a private company.
Correct, private company. Okay, so the question is, if we're a private company, you didn't ask exactly why we're going to all of these conferences, but more of how many of these conferences are we going to? Yeah, or the same idea. And the thing is, holistic industries, we have been saying, is the largest MSO you never heard of. And recently, after a big raise, $55 million raise, we thought this was the time. We've been sort of operating under the radar, winning licenses, you know, expanding from state to state, getting to the West Coast, getting Midwest, getting East Coast. And this was the time where we're going to announce our raise, announced me joining the company. And there's sort of a lot, flurry of activity that we just want more people to know about this. So there might be a time where we may be making different moves. And right now, to go from a company that you never heard of to a company that everyone's heard of takes a bunch of conferences to get there. Yeah. So thanks for your question. Yeah, sure. Yeah, geographic footprint. So started in D.C., moved to Maryland, Pennsylvania, Massachusetts, Michigan, California. There's details where I could speak to offside in terms of number of stores, cultivation, et cetera. And then in development, it's unbelievable as we wait for, like everyone else, New Jersey, it goes on and on there. So by next year, we expect to have about 20 dispensaries open in 6 to 10 states. I don't know the answer to that question, but I appreciate it. Is the music saying that you're trying to get rid of me? No. Okay, so with that, I'll say thank you very much. Appreciate it.